Very well, then. Today we will be focusing on page 81, where we left off. By the end of this page, in the last paragraph, the text says, Anthropodicy will take care of verifying the full animic balance of religious salvation in personal life, whereas the task of theodicy will be to justify rationally the truth of the religion that's capable of providing it. That's why theodicy will be conceived by Florensky as the rational path where man comes to recognize religion's saving character and to the conviction that God, whom holiness is being attributed to, is truly holy and worthy of that name. And so we could say, what does Pavel Florensky mean here? In this case, by theodicy, or what does his work about this subject consist of? And it's to carry out the rational justification for God in his holiness. And this, we can say, already points to a very important factor. First, in general, and since the rise of rationalism that had already been generated since the 16th century, we tend to consider theology, or theology used to be considered, an entirely rational task, or as a humanly rational work. And therefore, in this sense, it was up to men to try to discover, increasingly by rational means, God's very reality. But instead, Florensky will try to break with this subjectivity, and he will say that the only thing that can lead us to a deep conception of theodicy is God's own holiness. So in this sense, what it means is to start from the objective reality. And what this means is that, to Florensky, theodicy and theology in general is not precisely a mere intellectual job done by men, but that it actually has to do with the experience of God in the field of reason. And this is very important. Why? Because to acknowledge the experience of God in the field of reason will take us now precisely to reformulate, on the one hand, the status that ever since the rise of modernity has been attributed to reason, thus reason as a self-producer of reality itself. And so, depending on reason's capacity, reality itself will, in this sense, acquire consistency. Not to Florensky. To Florensky, God is someone real, whose experience will indeed have a clear impact in the field of reason itself. And so, to Florensky, it's fundamental not to start from reason, but to start from God himself, and therefore have an experience, influence, and impact generated in reason itself. In this way, thus, Florensky, the same as, for example, Saint Anselm, will think of God as living person, and not as a mere abstract category, the way that, in this sense, Kant did. And so, to Florensky, the experience of God in the field of reason will ultimately lead us to a contemplative rise. And therefore, to a deep acquisition of reason's true purpose, which is none other than salvation. And not self-evidence, right? This confined reason that seems to remain limited in its own elaborations. That's why, in the following quote, Florensky says, "Reason craves for salvation. The human mind, Martin Luther said somewhere, is like a drunk man standing at a great height. If held from one side, he falls from the other. Such is the imaginative expression of reason's antinomicity, breaking up in antinomies and dead in its being, according to its understanding. Reason looks for the principle of life and firmness. Salvation in the theoretical sphere is thought up firstly as a stability of mind. That is to say, as an answer to the question, how is reason possible? And if religion promises this stability, then the task of theodicy is to show that this stability can really be given. And precisely how. And so, this contemplative rise, consists precisely of reaching rational stability. This rational stability, which is, let's say, what the very search itself for reason concentrates on. Or perhaps we could put it in other words. Reason, unlike what is commonly thought of today, doesn't start from itself, nor does it look for itself. Actually, reason is looking for a certain stability that can only be found in a contemplative rise, which is really none other than the experience that God Himself produces in reason itself. And in this sense, we could also talk about an authentic intellectual elevation. It's like receiving an illumination that doesn't really come from reason itself. This, at least regarding theodicy. But, as the text says down below, anthropodicy, for its part, is represented as the verification in the other dimensions of life itself of the salvation given by religion. It's not dwelling now in the field of reason, but it's looking for the real center from which salvation will be personally assimilated, thus the heart of man. So, on the one hand, what we have here is the anthropodicy. Oh, sorry, the theodicy. Here we would precisely have the theodicy. With this purpose. But the anthropodicy on the other hand will show us now, or perhaps we could say that it will try to actually address the way in which this salvation is personally taken on in man's life itself. So, in what way is it that salvation has an impact for all of life's dimensions? So in this sense, what is it that this rational stability will inquire about? Theodicy has to do with salvation. An anthropodicy with the experience of God, thus that salvation. Anthropodicy also starts from salvation. But this salvation, now, is not strictly directed towards the human being's rational dimension, but towards all of life's dimensions. And we can put it in more specific terms. All the other dimensions of life. These life's dimensions are indeed both internal and external. We could say then that what Florensky is indeed carrying out is to describe for us and explain to us the way in which salvation, hence the experience of God, has an impact on both reason and on all the other dimensions of man's life. And so we could say that in this sense, to Florensky, the fundamental thing is to also integrate the two basic dimensions of every human being. Here we would have reason and its relation to religion. And here instead we would find man's very center, that is to say, his heart. Or, as it has also sometimes been said, to grasp the profound relationship that salvation establishes with regard to reason and faith, the theoretical field and the practical field. And hence, reason is the theoretical field of human beings, and the heart as the practical field. All the other dimensions of human life that are not necessarily linked in a direct way with rationality. For example, concerning the emotions, affectivity in general, all the decisions that we make when we are living our lives in this world, and so on and so forth. And so we would have the theoretical and the practical precisely addressed from the theodicy and the anthropodicy. And so this is not about two separate projects, but about two, let's say, inquiries, trying to delve and look deeply into each one of these dimensions that are precisely part of the same existence. And so that's why to Florensky the fundamental thing is to grasp reason, or the experience of God in reason, through dogma. And to grasp the experience of God, thus salvation in the heart of man, through the sacrament or the sacraments. And so here indeed we see how Florensky is developing in this sense. Let's put it like this. An inquiry looking to address the complete reality of human life and its corresponding relation with regard to God himself, whether in the field of reason, in the entirety of the field of reason, or in the field of the heart, and therefore all of the other dimensions of human life, and thus the theoretical and the practical. And that's why, two lines below, the text says, if in theodicy man experiences God in his reason, in anthropodicy, man experiences himself. He discovers his heart. He calibrates the thickness of deceit regarding divine truth, and he heads towards purification. And so, what we see is that, in short, the holiness of God himself purifies reason and purifies the heart. And so, we could say, in brief terms, what does the experience of God from theodicy as reason consist of? It consists precisely in our own acknowledgement of our ways of thinking. In God's light. Thus, we could say to purify our ways of thinking. And in the heart, instead, it's about purifying our ways of living. Why? Because to Florensky, there is something clear, which is the following. It's not about, for example, as when one decides to become a Christian, in general, one decides the criteria that should be adopted to be able to reach the perfect measure. No, it's actually about letting ourselves be completely transformed and renewed by God himself. And in this case, by the very experience of God. In this sense, by holiness. And so, to Florensky, it's clear, for example, that holiness, taken on from theodicy, has the task of having God, in his experiencing, manage to purify our ways of thinking, and therefore changing our reason. Our ways of thinking are thus, ultimately, transcended. They are, to use this language, transformed by the experience of God. And on the other hand, this same experience of God, now directed towards the heart, also takes us to transform or change in a radical way our ways of living. Hence, in short, the experience of God in reason and in the heart brings along a new life. So, this is not about the ways in which we can think of God, but about the ways in which God himself impacts our thinking, changing it completely. And, for example, we can see this as, in the case, for instance, of a convert, and the apostles say, okay, now I understand what I couldn't before. Okay? We would like sometimes to be able to grasp certain things, or the behavior of some saints, and we cannot fully understand why they behaved the way they did. They behaved the way they did because the experience of God actually has an impact on their reason, and thus salvation is manifested as the deep transformation of the usual ways of thinking. And therefore, it will also have the result of a transformation of our usual ways of living. And so, what this really means is that we have to realize that the experience of God, both in reason, the theoretical level, or in the heart, the practical level, is precisely in the task of promoting, or in this sense, proposing conversion. Conversion, therefore, consists of allowing God to be the one transforming us according to his will, and so to stop engaging and trying to take on this role ourselves. And so that's why the two last lines of this page 82 say, in anthropodicy, man takes on the ascetic and sacramental path of conversion, so to assimilate and fulfill the truth acknowledges just in his holiness, thus acquiring a full existential stability, the status of human reality, subjectively and objectively justified. In one word, Makaria, thus happiness, and eschatologically, eternal rest, that corresponds to certainty in the rational field. So what we must understand in this sense is the way in which God works in his creatures their own salvation. As we have said, this is what we're trying to understand here, this first stage, the way in which God works the salvation of his creatures precisely in them. And it's through giving this same creature the fundamental experience of God, which is holiness itself. And how this holiness then opens the way for reason into a dimension that it couldn't reach on its own. And it also promotes the transformation of the heart in such a way that it will be reflected precisely through the works or the behavior that is taken on. That's why the Lord would tell us, "By their fruits you shall know them." And so these works that are being performed are the result of a heart that has been reached by the experience of God, thus by holiness. But that at the same time, these works are being backed up by ways of thinking that are appropriate and correspond to this behavior. Hence, stability has been reached, which is to say, Christian coherence. And this is fundamental, because between these two things, what we are indeed receiving is precisely coherence. Heart and reason go hand in hand. They are not, therefore, separate or in irreconcilable conflict with one another. No, they simply go hand in hand, precisely to carry out the very project that God has in mind, which is to say, salvation. So, this coherence is a coherence of salvation. And what does coherence of salvation mean, holiness? Here, for example, we can already detect something extraordinary. Holiness is not something like a strange or magical thing that occurs pretty much immediately. No, holiness itself entails a process. And this process, indeed, requires the actions of first going through reason, and in this case also to go through the very heart of the person, so that holiness can manifest not the most optimal aspects of man as such, but rather that it can show itself as an authentic manifestation of the experience of God. That is holiness. And so the first thing that we can already see about holiness is, first, it doesn't have a human measure. For example, one thing is to be a good man, or even a very good man, and another thing is, for example, to be a bearer of holiness, because holiness is the experience of God in man. That is holiness. And in the world. Why in the world? Because man is immersed in a general context that effectively links him in a direct way to both, first, all other people, and also then to all other things. And so, perhaps getting a little bit more philosophical, what's and who's are always in relation, things and persons, with a man. And so when a man truly receives the experience of God, thus holiness, this experience of God will likewise be extended or shared into and by everything that's surrounding this man. And so here, to move forward in this experience of God in man and in the world, thus holiness, thus coherence of salvation, which is a balance or stability of reason, and therefore also balance or stability in behavior, Florensky will mention that this is about a dynamic. It's important to note that this journey is a dynamic journey, and that in this dynamic, it is about rising just as much as it is about declining. And so this experience of God, this holiness, this coherence of salvation is not a magic trick, but in short, and to put it simply, it is a defined process. And this process is nothing more than the dynamic itself of sanctification that God himself carries out in man. And so the first quote of page 83 says, "The first path, justification of God or theodicy, is possible only through the force of God's grace. And the second path, the path of man's justification or anthropodicy, is also only possible through divine force, because we believe in God and we live in God only through God, not ourselves. For that reason, we could consider the first path as the elevation of the grace in us to God, and the second as the descending of grace onto our depths, both theodicy as an otis, which is to say, our elevation to God, and anthropodicy as oos, which is to say, God's descending onto us, are fulfilled in the human heart because of divine energy." And so we could say, this dynamic, this experience of God in man and in the world, is what we can now easily understand as the dynamic of grace. It is here that we can find this dynamic of grace, and therefore, how in this first dynamic, during the first moment of the theodicy, what happens is that our reason is being effectively elevated to God. We're elevated to God. And what does this mean? That we move from mere thinking to contemplating. What is to contemplate? Contemplation is to perceive things in the light of truth. And therefore, if we delve a little bit more into this aspect, which is very important, we see that contemplation transforms then also reason's way of behaving. Why? Because reason in itself is primarily active, right? Reason sets out to establish both its procedures and the results it wants to achieve. But instead, in contemplation, reason reaches its stability because it turns now into something that's passive. Reason no longer acts. Reason now receives. And therefore, it ultimately perceives what it is being shown. I don't know if this is clear. This is very important. So, what we see here is that we move from the active to the passive. We go or move from mere thinking, active, to a passive contemplating. In contemplating, reason no longer contributes with its own, okay? It no longer has to make an effort to establish its own categories of comprehension. Plain and simple, reason now receives everything that's manifested to it in the light of truth. And that's why it reaches a stability. And what does it mean? It reaches intellectual joy. And what does intellectual joy consist in? In reason perceiving the reality of things in light of the truth. But in anthropodicy instead, the dynamic of grace is just the other way around. In the dynamic of grace, what we now see is that we move from contemplating from where we were elevated in the transfiguration of thought, and now we will be installed in the concrete reality of human activity. Now we go back after having been elevated to contemplation. We then go back, as we said, to earth, now taking into account the authentic reality of man. And so, as we have been saying, in anthropodicy, what we see is that we're being delivered back to earth from heaven. This return, so to say, to earth is precisely the way in which we will be growing and we will be increasingly purifying this coherence of salvation. Why? Because holiness, as the experience of God in man and in the world, has indeed the entailment of developing from all kinds of complicated relationships that are one of the definite and distinctive features of all the relationships in human affairs. And that's why we should realize that it is necessary and fundamental to undertake these two paths to fully understand the actual dynamic of salvation. So, To put it briefly, what we see is that what is being presented here is precisely the elevation and the incarnation. And so here we could say, in theodicy, we find the dynamic of elevation. But in anthropodicy instead, the dynamic of incarnation is highlighted. The incarnation, which would be the step from the divine to the human, right? The Son of God made man. And therefore, it has, let's say, taken on the human dimension in all of its entirety. And that's why it is fundamental that this situation that we see, both of elevation and of incarnation, and in its corresponding dynamic, Florensky calls it synergy. Good. And so we were saying that in this dynamic of grace, Florensky indeed detects that synergy is present. And what is synergy? It is the divine-human collaboration. And so we could say the communion of God with man, the way in which grace collaborates with human beings. And so synergy, which would be precisely this human-divine collaboration, is at the same time contained in the typical conception of the Eastern Fathers about the cooperation between man and divine grace. And so what Florensky actually finds is that this synergy implies or entails a collaboration which is divine-human. And it is the way in which we can actually start intuiting the following. Grace does not act in man in a way that could be by any means unjustified, but that grace only acts in man through a justification. And what would the justification be in this sense? To accept the experience of God in our lives. Or to put it in other terms, grace does not do violence in man. Man is called to accept, receive, and collaborate with this grace. So in this sense, an openness is required. Good. And so precisely through this synergy, what we can understand is that, as we mentioned, something is being uncovered, which is, as we said, truly rooted in the Eastern Fathers, and it is the collaboration and the cooperation of the divine and the human. God's initiative looking for his creature's salvation, and at the same time, the creature's reception of this actual salvation. And so in this sense, the experience of holiness. And why? Because what we see is that it's not only about, let's say, understanding the transforming force of the incarnation, but also to take it on ourselves. And so, we could say in this sense, precisely to go through a process of assimilation of Christ. Okay? Truth is not only to be known, but also to be assimilated. And so in this light, we could say, truth must be incarnate. Just as the Word became flesh, and He Himself is the truth, so we must then also be incarnate in this truth. So in this sense, we must be fully assimilated by this truth, transfigured by this truth. That's why on page 84, for example, in note 99, the fourth line, we find in the text that Florensky says, Larchette, who is a theologian, ascesis in the Orthodox Church does not have the reduced sense that it has frequently been given in the West, but that it designates that which every Christian should perform to effectively benefit from the salvation given by Christ. In the eyes of the great tradition of the Orthodox Church, the work of salvation appears as a synergy of divine grace given by the Holy Spirit and the effort that every baptized person must make. That's the effort that every baptized person must individually make to be open to this grace and make it his. An effort made throughout the whole life, at every moment, and throughout all the acts of existence. And so, indeed, the first thing that Florensky discovers is that we too require an effort. But not an active effort, but a passive effort. And so an effort to receive more and more of this experience of God in reason and in the heart. And so to really get involved in a full way, in a total and incarnate way, with this salvation that God Himself is giving us. And for this reason, Florensky will now address another fundamental aspect about the way in which this collaboration is obtained. Or in brief terms, how is it that man does not give in to the holiest of the holy? And we see this in Florensky's quote on page 85, which is actually extracted from a text by Florensky titled The Philosophy of Cult. It says, "How can the weak face of man get in contact with the divine truth? How is it that the divine energy does not reduce the creature's misery to ashes?" These and other similar questions demand an ontological clarification. Translating it to the poor and blunt language of earthly comparisons, we would say, how is it possible for the holy chalice not to melt like wax, and for our eyes not to be blinded by the unbearable radiation of that within it? What would happen if a particle of sun fell into the cup? But here is that before which the sun is nothing but shadows, and the chalice remains unscathed. It would seem as though for a brief moment the priest would hold a storm cloud in his hand, an impetuous movement, and the shaking of a thunderbolt would hit him. These are images, but no kind of images will be able to transmit the contrast between God and the creature, we could say between holiness and the sinner, a contrast that has to be necessarily made in order to make the justification of the creature possible. The anthropodicy has to clarify the ontology of this contrast made between the whole and nothingness. And so we could say, Florensky is also interested in uncovering already the possibility of God coming into contact with his creature without annihilating it, without destroying it. Remember that also in the Old Testament, the prophets were fully aware that the simple presence of God could easily nullify them. For example, Isaiah, "Woe is me, I have seen God and I'm ruined." And so really, who as a creature can stand the Almighty, God Himself? And so it's an image, right? Like Florensky said, what would happen if a particle of the sun fell into this chalice? And now if the sun is nothing next to God, what happens then with this situation? And that's why we see that in this sense, it is necessary to make a contrast. And so this contrast ultimately takes us to integrate all of reality in holiness. And this is one of the fundamental objectives that Florensky will try to develop. To integrate all of reality into holiness. And so, this would be one of the fundamental efforts that Florensky will try to make. And why? Because it says on page 86, about 6 lines before the end of the paragraph, in a theoretical sense, it means that anthropodicy, as an intellectual effort, is born out of an internal necessity of the theology of the sacrament, which will necessarily bring to light all the ontological structures that grace itself has to sanctify. And therefore, it will be characterized as a sacramental philosophy. And so, these ontological structures are actually those human realities that effectively need to be sanctified, hence justified, and hence saved. And so, we can see now the way in which God Himself performs His project of salvation, fixing, so to say, and arranging these ontological structures that, in man, have been deeply and truly injured by the reality of sin. And so, what we see here is that these ontological structures correspond precisely to our way of being. A way of being that has, or that encompasses, all possible fields of existence. For example, these intellectual fields, and also emotional and behavioral fields, also about habits and customs, and so on and so forth. And so, what we see is that, in this project of salvation, God himself, okay, is the one sanctifying these ontological structures that had been injured, or in more precise terms, that had been deeply injured because of sin. And so what we see is that grace, in this sense, will sanctify that which, as we have mentioned, has remained away from this very holiness. Okay, so this would be like the rescue move that God will carry out. That's why Florensky will consider integrating all of reality into holiness, as therefore implying the elaboration of a concrete metaphysics. The concrete metaphysics, in this sense, has nothing to do with a kind of metaphysics that's entirely abstract, and thus a kind of metaphysics that would ultimately seem to be reduced to the abstract concepts, but that don't seem to really understand anything about concrete reality. And so that's why it's very important to Florensky that metaphysics go deep into reality itself, and not that metaphysics be some kind of abstract or theoretical substitute of that reality of life. And so that metaphysics, in this sense, can uncover the deep realities of life in their concrete situations. Aspects that are indeed entirely Catholic. For example, if one looks into the literary work of George Bernanos, or of Maxence van der Mersch, or of someone like Charles Péguy, just to mention a few, we'll see that what's fundamental is not really about the conceptual capacity that we can elaborate, but, to put it in simple terms, it's rather about digging deeply into all of the concrete realities in life, no matter how complicated these realities may be. Or, for example, we can also put it like this, no matter how difficult, or regardless of how difficult we may find the access. And that's the reason why, what Florensky's looking for is to acknowledge this openness that every being has to the sanctifying action of divine grace. And so here, for example, we can see two concrete aspects. This concrete metaphysics, from which Florensky wants to integrate all of reality into holiness, also acknowledges that man needs to be sanctified. Thus, he needs to be saved. And therefore, this implies that man is not actually, in his profound reality, in a state of salvation. Or we can also try to use more usual terms. We could say that man is indeed a sinner, and therefore he needs, actually, to be rescued from sin. But on the other hand, this implies as well that this man, regardless of how degraded he is in his profound reality, or in his own self as a sinner, hasn't been deprived, not even because of that, of being open to the redeeming action of God. And so what we can actually see here is that this concrete metaphysics is indeed capable of describing for us the actual step of being a sinner in one's concrete reality as a sinner, in the ontological structures or concrete ways of being as a sinner, and also in the dynamic of salvation that grace performs in him. We could actually say, right, that the description of this concrete metaphysics is the step or the transit from the sinner to he who has been saved by grace. Thus, from the sinner to the sanctified. From the sinner to the one who has ultimately received this redeeming grace. Right, so the sanctifying action. Right, so it would be, indeed, some kind of triduum, kind of Easter triduum. Right, to take on the painful passion, the death on the cross, and then finally access the resurrection. And that's why, if we take a look at it on page 86, on this page, about four lines before the beginning of section 2.3, the text says, "This path of concrete metaphysics will follow the sacramental forms of the incarnation. constituting thus, notes her author, a philosophical propedeutic for Christology. And so, what we see is that this concrete metaphysics is indeed a philosophical propedeutic, a preparation, right? For Christology. And here it's worth being a little bit more precise. What does Florensky mean by Christology? Not a theoretical study of Christ, but the reception of Christ. Christology is first reception of Christ. And so second, incarnation. That is Christology. Right, thus, sanctification. That's Christology. Why? Because indeed, today we, apparently, due to the intellectual standards that we have assumed and that are heavily abstract, when, for example, one talks about Christology, we think of some kind of theoretical or systematic study of Christ, but that ultimately has really nothing to do with my life. And this is the reason, or the aspect, the one which indeed Florensky will forcefully oppose. Here, thus, we have the concrete metaphysics. Why? Because Christianity is not only a theory. It's first and foremost an experience. Christianity is holiness. And this is something that Florensky will very frequently and continuously insist on. And in short, what he will explain to us is the following. If Christianity really is holiness, now we have to understand how to carry out this dynamic of sanctification, or what we call in this sense, the dynamic of grace. This is fundamental because, as I have already mentioned on various occasions, it would seem as though today we're also guilty of naivete, right? Yeah, we talk about grace. Yeah, we say God's grace and blah blah. Yeah, but we don't understand the concrete reality of this person that I'm referring to. It's like asking someone to go swimming without first realizing that he doesn't even have arms or legs, or neither arms or legs. And so I tell him, yeah, you get in and do this. But it's not that. We ultimately need to be aware of whom we're talking to and the concrete reality that he's in, so that after we actually arrive at things, we can then elaborate a philosophical propedeutic for Christology. And so we don't want a systematic, theoretical, and abstract study of Christ, but rather the Lord's actual incarnation, thus the reception of Christ, and therefore sanctification. And that's why we were eventually told by Henri de Lubac, the church is actually nothing more than the family of those who have been sanctified. It's the church of the sanctified. And so those who have actually made a decision to accept Christ in their lives, those are the saints. Let's get rid of this notion that the saints are just the thaumaturgists, that the saint is the one who performs ostensive, visual, eye-catching, and extraordinary miracles. This, just as Saint Faustina Kowalska told us, and I won't get tired of repeating it, is mere ornament. It's really just the flowers. But the fertile soil of holiness is something else. The true essence or root of holiness is the acceptance, and therefore the reception of grace in my life. Thus, to accept that God saved me. And that's what we want, because sanctification, in this sense, at the same time, invokes two very concrete meanings. First, holiness. But not only holiness, but also salvation. These are the saints. And thus, ultimately, those who have taken seriously the saving project of God Himself, and who have agreed to receive this very project that God wants to fulfill in each and every human being. Alright? And so here we clearly see now the fundamental aspects on which, indeed, Florensky will start working in a serious way. That's why what we see here is that Florensky never wrote a treatise on Christology, because Florensky was fully aware about what was really at stake, which was not an intellectual discussion, but the actual salvation of souls. And this is so important that it cannot be reduced to the elaboration of a mere theoretical treatise, but it implies a concrete metaphysics that can take us, in this sense, to understand the actual dynamic in which grace is being fulfilled. And so what we see is that this concrete metaphysics, in this particular sense, related to sanctification as holiness and salvation, has to do with the dynamic of the spiritual life. And we could ask, what is this dynamic of the spiritual life? Precisely, the way in which grace works. And that is precisely also what Florensky will try to describe throughout his Anthropodicy, and even also within the Theodicy. And so, the dynamic of the spiritual life requires, or we can say that it first implies, to know, indeed, what a reality without salvation is like. And so, how is our reality deprived of this project of salvation, which is to say, deprived of holiness? And on the other hand, how is this project of salvation being carried out? And so, we could put it differently. It is indeed important that we realize what actually has to be sanctified. And how is it that this is done? And so it's not enough to just talk about holiness. But if holiness obtains, if grace obtains, it is because in this sense there is something that has to be rescued. And so the first thing that we have to understand is what this state of non-salvation consists of. Right, which is none other than the state of sin. It is this. The state of non-salvation is the state of sin. Once getting this clear, it's about seeing the way in which grace, thus God's project of salvation, is being carried out or fulfilled, as we have said, in man. That's why on page 88, at the beginning of page 88, in the first line, the text says, Florensky is aware that in order to address the last chapter of all the Christological Anthropodicy, and thus the very center around which everything else revolves, namely Christ, more personal maturity is necessary, and also a bigger collection of experiences and skills. But this means that Christology is very highly valued, and that in it, everything has its foundation and peak. And so what we see is that, indeed, too, Florensky, a fundamental thing is that this reception of Christ takes us to realize that it is Christ himself, and therefore actually the Holy Trinity, since the project of salvation is none other than the whole Trinitary work being carried out, would precisely be the foundation and peak of the dynamic of spiritual life. Or in brief terms, with his incarnation, he has indeed shown us the actual way of being the Father's children, like he is. And not only in an earthly sense, but in the full authentic sense, in a deep sense, through this incarnation. That's why, to highlight all this spiritual dynamic, takes us now to realize then that, to put it in very brief terms, what Florensky is actually developing is an experimental Christology. Remember this. A kind of Christology that really transmits to us the experience of God, both in reason and in the heart. And so what we see is that this grace is to Florensky effectively translated as an experimental Christology. And thus, a life event. This life event is actually nothing more than the fulfillment of the salvation that Christ has precisely brought into the world. Now listen to this. This experimental Christology, this event, which is actually of eternal life, and that's why I decided to write this between brackets, this experimental Christology, and as we said, this eternal life event, will indeed increasingly address fundamental aspects that cannot be left aside. For example, first, the very structure of human life. And so, this experimental Christology, this reception of God's saving project, hence of holiness, indeed will have to address aspects such as, first, the very structure of human life, second, the deep and internal configuration of the human soul. And so what we see is first to detect the very structure of human life, and second, the deep and internal configuration of the soul. Third, this experience of salvation, of holiness, the experimental Christology, in fact, this is holiness. And so in this sense, we could summarize by saying that this experimental Christology is none other than holiness itself, and it also involves the description of the profiting of the experiential situations. This profiting of the experiential situations is pretty much as when we sometimes say that from bad things, good things always come, okay? Or that where there was great evil, great good will also be found. Or that where sin abounds, as St. Paul said, grace abounds all the more, okay? And so, within these dynamics, we will also be understanding the future course of existence. Also, for example, teaching. Okay? And also, let's say, to acknowledge and overcome the properly human way of existing. And therefore, to take on this dynamic motion of grace as a personalization, and hence, as holiness. And so, what we see is that holiness does require, in this sense, the reception of divine action. Or, perhaps, if we try to put it in simple terms, then we could say that in order to be a saint, what is really required is the willingness of God acting. We could say that that would be a fundamental point. Holiness is not something imposed. Holiness is reception. And therefore, as we will be looking into later on, holiness involves meekness, obedience, pursuit, and so on and so forth. That's why, to Florensky on his part, this experimental Christology as holiness now constitutes a universally human way. What does it mean for Florensky to also identify in this experimental Christology a universally human way? It means that God can fulfill his project of salvation in any man, regardless of his condition, his situation, or his state. So for God, nothing is impossible. And in this sense, it doesn't mean that any man, just by his own effort, can get to achieve this holiness. No, it means that God can save everyone, no matter the situation. That's why I told you that, indeed, we can now see here an objective principle. So the acknowledgement of God as a living reality that indeed saves and rescues his creatures. That's why, too, Florensky, it's very important that we do not lose sight of this universally human way which is none other than God's salvation. This is the universally human way, God's salvation. God can save all his creatures. But this cannot actually be performed in a mechanical way, because it involves a living process. This is the dynamic of the religious life. To be a saint is to let oneself be filled by the experience of God in my life. That's to be a saint. To let oneself be filled by the presence of God in my own life, concerning all levels and all my being. My thinking, my working, my feeling, my considering, and just about everything. And for that reason, what we see is that we cannot accomplish this through a mere mechanical effort, right? As if this could be fulfilled in some kind of automatic way. We actually need a profound motion of personalization, of assimilation, of reception, thus of personalization. And so, God's salvation must be personalized, taken on, received in an intimate and personal way. Someone who had already intuited this was Saint Augustine, when Saint Augustine said, "The one who created you without you will not save you without you." Because remember that when we mentioned synergy, we said that it was a collaboration of the divine and the human. In short, salvation is to accept God and to ultimately accept that he intervene in my entire life. We see this, for example, on page 89. In the last quote, by the end of the page, the recollection, but this recollection cannot be a mechanical effort. Spiritual life, by its very essence, is impregnated with the personal character. That's why, if, in the universally human way, we would have to study man himself deprived of content, who possesses in himself a minimum part of spiritual life, in the way, for all men, it's necessary to study he who in himself possesses the highest grade of spiritual life, and that is the Son of Man. O Theos to on anthropon, he who in himself contains ideal humanity. And hence this ideal humanity, who is Jesus Christ, manifested as person, and not only as a simple man. And so we have a universally human way, but here, God's salvation personalized means not only in general or universal terms, but that now it's made concrete in every man in particular, the way in which every one of us indeed will be getting involved in this dynamic of grace. And from there then, on page 91, at the beginning of the second line, we see the following. Definitely, Christ appears as an ontological memory of the human path, finally traveled, and in it transfigured. And so, what we see is that this personalized God's salvation at the same time entails two things. First, journey. And second, fulfillment. Okay, is it clear? It entails then a journey, but also in this sense, fulfillment. This continuous journey that will be stretched throughout our entire lives, and this gradual fulfillment where the gained ground is never again lost, is precisely what we also call in this concrete metaphysics transfiguration. Thus, sanctification. And so, as God's salvation is being personalized, this process of sanctification is given, which we will be acquiring throughout all our existence. And so, what we see is that, actually, holiness is not really something like the highest grade of human possibilities. No, holiness is actually the highest grade of the reception of God in my life. The criteria are then reversed. Holiness is not really something akin to moral superiority, and neither is it something like the exhibition of the highest parameters of human behavior. No, we could even also try to manifest it through a very simple formula. Less me, more him equals holiness. And the reverse. Less him, more me equals less holiness. It's that simple, okay? It's necessary that he grow and I decrease. And why? Precisely so that this journey of fulfillment be manifested in our lives and the transfiguration in a personal way. And this transfiguration, Florensky insists, is an experience. That's why he talked about an experimental Christology. Remember, holiness then is now shown as the experience of God in my life. And this is something important that had gone unnoticed in various ways. For example, usually when we think of saints or when we refer to saints one way or another, maybe we're considering what the saints did. But we're not really concentrating on what the saints lived in a very deep way. And what every saint lived is the same dynamic of personalization, thus the annulment of their self to make way for him. Not I, but he. That is the profound experience of all saints. And thus, in such a way that our attention now must be refocused on the central core of the question. Let's not think about saints as the ones who performed miracles. Instead, let's think of saints as the ones who decided to receive God in their lives. And God then took care, and actually will take care, as he has always done, of everything else. That's why what Florensky wants is to describe or to transmit to us this fundamental experience of sanctification, of conversion, or in one word, Christianity, precisely through both anthropodicy and also theodicy. And so to realize then that we are being molded, okay? We're being molded precisely to Christ. Why? Because Christ is the mold. Christ is the mold from which we will be acquiring form and figure. We're being molded precisely in Christ. All of our being acquires Christ's form. But of course, and therefore, to regain the divine likeness. Why? Because he's not only man, but he's also God. And so he is molding us, so to say, until we ultimately reflect Christ's face. And this is very true, okay? Listen, the saint does not reflect what's human. The saint reflects God himself. He reflects God's face. And hence, Christ's face. And so what we see is that in this move of personalization, the transfiguration returns the face of Christ as the result. The saint, therefore, does not reflect himself. Neither does he reflect or express what's merely human. The saint manifests the divine, the face of Christ, the same which is once again incarnate in human reality. In this case, in a particular man, in generic terms. And for this reason, a very interesting thing to highlight here is that Florensky is, let's say, driving us to the very process of sanctification. How is it that God's redeeming work is performed precisely, as we have been saying, in men? And for this purpose, Florensky doesn't start from scratch. Actually, this is mentioned on page 92, that Father Pavel follows the marks and steps of that pioneer of Russian religious renaissance, Bukharev, whose letters he edited and he himself introduced. And so note this, Bukharev's letters were actually edited and published by Florensky himself. And why? Because this endured prophet, Bukharev, hero and martyr of the intellectuals and seekers of God, who always kept, just like Florensky, a childlike purity, listen, abandoned monasticism to live a lay life in marriage and in the world. Considering his painful and alarming decision as a prophetic gesture indicating the Russian Church, a missionary path to worldliness that in all fields had to be permeated with the light of God's kingdom. It's the vision of a new secularity, new and unparalleled in the East, based on the real priesthood of the Christians. Or to put it differently, this prophetic gesture by Bukharev to Florensky was indeed quite luminous, because it invited us to acknowledge that God's saving work, thus the experience of God, thus holiness, is not only given in certain already established fields, for example, through a consecrated life, or through, like in this case, monasticism, right? As perhaps the most radical religious form to be able to follow God's paths. But that this withdrawal from monasticism to take on a lay life, and also in this sense, to unfold this mission in marriage, entailed that the face of Christ is not actually just limited to certain conditions, but that it can ultimately obtain in any case. And why? Because now what we see is that, indeed, this prophetic gesture by Bukharev, and that Florensky himself really understood, consists in realizing that holiness is the life in Christ in the world. Thus, as Bukharev calls it, in the secularized city. And this is fundamental. Christ's face is not limited to certain special situations or to certain already established conditions, such as a life in a convent or another situation that's merely reduced to a monastery. Actually, what we see is that this dynamic, this transfiguration, this experience of God, arrives at a spirituality of life in Christ and on the inside of the world. And so to realize, I insist that it's not necessary for us to go through particular conditions to have access to this experience. We see this on page 92, almost at the end, in one of the last lines. It says, "For this reason, Father Pavel will not be in the condition of addressing a Christological contemplation, thus understood, until after having been initiated in the last stage of the mystery, hence in the praxis. And so, the Florenskian Christology can certainly not be sought for in his writings, since both theodicy and anthropodicy, in their full, are nothing more than a propedeutic to Christ." And so here, it's worth highlighting this fundamental aspect. First, Florensky doesn't write what he thinks. He narrates what he lives. And this is a fundamental thing. Because we could, for example, also fall in the temptation of giving a free way to the subtlety of our thoughts, right? To our mental juggling. To give it a description, like Peter Abelard, who eventually had to be corrected by Saint Bernard. As in, the fact of looking more for novelty than for truth. And even the arrogance of having unparalleled and astonishing thoughts that nobody else had ever had the capability of expressing or of developing. And so, it's very important to realize that actually Florensky doesn't write what he thinks. He narrates what he lives. And this narration involves that then the only thing that's being done is giving evidence, written and testimonial evidence, that kind of evidence, of what the Lord has been fulfilling in our lives. And it's here precisely where the living force of the testimony lies, and thus the forcefulness of this transfiguration, the experience of God in our lives, experience of salvation, experience of holiness, the same way as the great John Henry Newman experienced it and actually affirmed, to be a saint and to be saved is the same thing. And so, not only should we learn to put the complexity of reality together, but it's also our duty to start right away identifying holiness with salvation. To experience holiness is the same thing as to experience salvation. For a simple reason, because Christ is salvation made flesh, and he's the incarnate saint. In other words, to experience holiness and to experience salvation is the experience of God. In short, the most authentic and genuine Christian experience. And it is this experience what we today should retake. This is what we are being asked to be Christians, to experience salvation, to experience holiness, to experience God. All right? Let's leave it here. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.